Hello, good evening. Welcome back to our reading stream, reading Forbidden History. We missed last week, but we're going to pick it up where we left off. I am only going to read two articles. They are short, but I'm only going to read two. And I may have to have a cough drop in between because I'm trying real hard to come down with a cold, and you may hear it in my voice already. So, let's jump right on into it. Hey, how's it going? How are you tonight? Was that Diggs? How are you tonight, Diggs? Gonna go ahead and jump into this. So we are starting into the part four of the book, Searching for the Fountainhead, and this first article is Megalithic England, the Atlantean Dimensions, a Conversation with John Mitchell, by J. Douglas Kenyon. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna go ahead and put that cough drop in now. I can already tell I'm gonna need it. All right. Among those who have argued in their writings that there was once a great and shining, albeit forgotten to history, fountainhead of civilization, whose ghosts even now continue to haunt us, few have been more eloquent than John Mitchell. The author of more than a score of works on ancient mysteries, sacred geometry, UFOs, unexplained phenomena, and the like, Mitchell is familiar to American readers primarily through his visionary classic, The View Over Atlantis, a revised and rewritten version of this book published in 1995, is entitled The New View Over Atlantis. The Earth Spirit comprises Mitchell's profusely illustrated essays on the ways, shrines, and mysteries of the subtle, I better get straightened out here, or it's going to be excruciating. Subtle animating forces of the planet and their near universal celebration since the dawn of time. Mitchell argues that all across much of the earth are ancient earthworks and stone monuments built for an unknown purpose, and that their sheared features suggest they might be part of a worldwide system that he believes served the elemental science of the archaic civilization that Plato called Atlantis. Okay, the cough drop is not going to work. I don't know if you can hear it banging around in my mouth, but ain't gonna work. Okay. Okay. Plato called Atlantis. Mitchell suggests in this connection that the most significant modern discovery is that of Leys, a mysterious network of straight lines that link the ancient places of Britain and have their counterparts in China, Australia, South America, and elsewhere. In The New View Over Atlantis, the Cambridge-educated scholar's vision of a high megalithic civilization with a mastery of principles far beyond present-day understanding is so thoroughly and beautifully worked out that it becomes difficult, if not impossible, to credit orthodox notions that the sources of our megalithic heritage were but Stone Age hunter-gatherer societies with little on their primitive minds but survival and procreation. In detailed descriptions of phenomena such as the precise terrestrial and celestial alignments of ancient monuments along long ley lines, advanced ancient sciences of numbers and sacred geometry, and sophisticated prehistoric engineering, Mitchell paints a picture of a vast and coherent worldwide order beyond anything imaginable today. Quote, "We live within the ruins of an ancient structure, he wrote in the first edition of the New View over Atlantis, whose vast size has hitherto rendered it invisible. End quote. Engineering from... Start over. Emerging from current research is the awesome image of an ancient structure so great that its outlines have... Jeez. Skip a week and I can't read, man. Its outlines have heretofore escaped understanding. One patiently awaiting our ascent to a sufficient height whence its masterful design stretched out beneath us can at last be appreciated. Colin Wilson described the view over Atlantis as, quote, one of the great seminal works of our generation, a book which will be argued about for generations to come, end quote. In an interview with Atlantis Rising, Mitchell was asked if he had been keeping up with the new research by Graham Hancock, Robert Bovell, and others into celestial alignments of the Monument of... The Monument of Egypt's Giza Plain with the constellation Orion and other stars. He has, and here's an echo of evidence he has found in British sites in, quote, much older stone, end quote, where alignments with significant stars also indicate the route of the soul after death. Quote, everywhere in the ancient world you see this terrific obsession with death reflected in the orientation of monuments, end quote, he observes. To him, it seems plain that the ancients possessed a kind of science of immortality along the lines that Graham Hancock has suggested. Unlike Colin Wilson, who theorizes that the ancients possessed advanced psychic faculties but had no technologies as we understand the term, Mitchell believes it is very clear that they did. He sees it in their elaborate work of sighting and constructing monuments well before the pyramids, and he sees it in their highly developed sciences of numbers and geometry. Quote, it's truly very extraordinary that so many numerical harmonies are put into basically very simple structures, he marvels, and how they designed others to concentrate on the long term. In this very beautiful pattern is implied the kind of philosophy that says we can construct here on earth the path to the heavens, end quote. He cites the frequent use of the number 12, as in the 12 tribes of Israel, and a connection with the 12 signs of the zodiac, hinting at an attempt to order life on earth according to the pattern of things in the heavens. The question of technology becomes more pressing, but even more difficult to answer, when one considers how the giant stones of ancient sites were actually cut, tooled, and moved. Quote, it is a mystery, actually, he concedes, this incredible precision, and again, in megalithic times, the extraordinary weights involved, raising blocks of 100 tons or more, transporting them, and then setting them up. They used terrific labor ingenuity and, no doubt, principles that aren't recognized today, end quote. Could such principles have included some kind of levitation? Quote, there are very persistent references from the classical writers to the power of sound, he says. One of the use of song and music and tone to make things lighter, work songs where there's a rhythm got up, where you can move things without a lot of effort. That's a rough sentence, but it's a quote. End quote. Whatever lost secrets of ancients may have possessed, Mitchell believes that we can cover them, and in fact will when the time is right. quote, human ingenuity is such that we can do anything we want. If the ancient knowledge was actually needed, then it would return again. There's no doubt about that, he says. End quote. As to the suggestion that we may have been left behind caches of records, such as the legendary Hall of Records in Egypt, he thinks it's very likely that such treasure troves exist, but it's not certain we will recognize them when we see them. Quote, Plato went on about a certain canon of law possessed by the ancient Egyptians by which numerical proportions and musical harmonies which dominate a society enable it to continue on the same level for literally thousands of years. He explains, ancient civilization lasted far longer than we can conceive of today, so it seems to me that the whole society was based upon an understanding of the harmonies by which the universe is laid, and acting upon these by corresponding rituals and that sort of thing, could hold the society together through crises. End quote. However, he concedes, being sufficiently developed to appreciate the wisdom of such laws may be another matter. The possibility that we may have begun, at least in some quarters, to resonate in harmony with the ancient chords of wisdom could open the door to a return of ancient wisdom. In religious stories, such as the revelation of St. John, Mitchell sees the description of a new Jerusalem coming down ready-made through a parting of the heavens as the manifestation of an awakening and a wholesale change from the patterns of a previous age. Such a revelation comes, he believes, from nature, and it is invoked, he says. Quote, when we need it, we ask for it, and it comes. Today, when people are so uncertain, I think we are looking for a truth and understanding that is beyond this world of chaos, of secular theories, and of all the scientific theories that follow one after the other, but never establish anything. We're looking for the higher truth that is always there. When we ask for that, we'll get that. End quote. In a chaotic world where dissonance and dissonant music apparently reign supreme, there seems little hope that such a force can be overcome. But Mitchell remains optimistic. Quote, it will overcome itself, he says. Certainly it has always been recognized that music is the most powerful of the arts. As Plato said, forms of government eventually follow the forms of music. That's why the ancients were very careful in controlling music. No cacophony was allowed. The same music was heard at festivals every year, and people were held under a kind of enchantment whereby the mind was held under one influence. It didn't end the quote, but that's the end of the paragraph. And then it starts another quote. Music is by far the most powerful means for therapy. Certainly, the music and the other art forms, too, that we see now threatens chaos in society. It's a vessel that not only reflects what happens, but also eventually determines what will happen. As to what will come about, I have no idea. I think more and more it's in the hands of God, and that there is now working out an alchemical process, and that changes come about through nature, through the natural process of cause and effect. Things are chaotic, and we have a reaction and a yearning for a source of order. There's a quest for that, and an invocation of that, and then there follows a revelation. End quote. Can the hoped-for change come without cataclysm? Quote, every man-made thing, start that quote again. Every man-made thing, every created thing, comes to an end sooner or later, Mitchell says. It's as inevitable as tomorrow's sunrise that all these fruits shall have lain down, that which is artificial does not last long. Look at the fall of communism. It seemed so assured, so completely in control, and it vanished practically overnight, destroyed by its own inherent contradictions. People just couldn't stand it anymore. It's so like the description of the fall of Babylon in St. John's Revelation. One day it's going with all its wealth, parading its splendor, and the next day it's as if it never had been. There is no doubt that all the institutions we know will collapse. As to how orderly this process will be, the further we get into megalomania and dependence on artificial systems, the more drastic will be the reaction. End quote. Mitchell sees a clear parallel between the destruction of Babylon described in the book of Revelation and Plato's description of the fall of Atlantis, and he believes the story is a warning about the danger in certain order. Quote, Plato made it very clear he's describing a geometrical pattern, the ground plan of Atlantis, which is actually not adequate, like a man-made thing, based on the number 10, where his ideal city was based on the number 12. He saw in Atlantis the mortal element prevailed and it collapsed. Apparently that's another quote they've missed, because we start another quote in the next paragraph. It is about an error in the foundation laws, Mitchell says, which became more and more exaggerated and eventually led to the downfall of the whole thing. Life is bringing us through this process of revelation, what was not even conceivable 100 years ago or less. The idea of there being a cosmological pattern expressibly, numerically, geometrically, beautifully, which is the best possible reflection of the cosmos. That process establishes perfect patterns in one's own mind and then later on becomes the pattern for society. Quote, then of course, again over many generations, what began as a revelation becomes the iron law and becomes unjust and leads to that process whereby the ideal turns into Babylon and is fit for destruction. The best possible cosmological pattern that is kept up in the institutes of society will enable the society to last for a very long time. But no material thing lasts forever. Eventually it turns into dust. End quote. But the good news, says Mitchell, is that human nature will always outlive any system of tyranny imposed upon it, and like the phoenix, will rise again. Today, he believes, we are living like bats in the ruins of a haunted house, among the relics and ruins of the past, not just physically, but also mentally. Caught in outmoded forms of thought, if one is going to free oneself from the age-old spells, Mitchell says, one must challenge the dominant myths, as he once did, with the most dominant theory of biology, evolution. Quote, it's not exactly that they are wrong, he explains. It's that they are partial and arbitrary. That's the way they teach in school and college. You have to challenge them to get anywhere near adjusting your mind to the reality of things. If you take to heart anyone's scientific explanation, you will have an uneasy life. For, as you know, the theories that are portrayed as certainties are always changing. If you believe what they tell you in school now, by the time you get to be my age, you'll be very old-fashioned indeed. End quote. End article. I'm going to put this in for a second and drink some water. Interesting. I have actually never heard the fall of Atlantis compared to the fall of Babylon in Revelations, which, okay. I'll have to read through Revelations at some point. I think I read bits and pieces of it years ago, but I'll have to read through it one of these days and with Atlantis in mind. But anyway, if you have any thoughts on that, feel free to put them in chat. That's what this stream is for. Not just for me to read. It's for people to put their thoughts out there, too. Thoughts, questions, theories, whatever. And part of why I'm doing this is for my own enjoyment, to bring books to other people that they may not even know exist, discuss that stuff. But also, I'm a TTRPG guy, or I'm getting back into it after a very long time out, and I'm building a world, and so I'm taking little bits and pieces and ideas that this kind of stuff spurs. I'm writing those down for my world building. So that's another added aspect of this stream. So anyway, let's get into the next one. It is... a little over 6 pages. The other one was a little shorter than that. So the next one is, all of these are going to be Atlantis in some way. So this one is called Plato, the Truth. How does the credibility of the best known chronicler of Atlantis stand up? By Frank Joseph. And it starts off with a quote above the text. A quote of Robert Graves from the Greek myths, and it is, "The Egyptian legend of Atlantis, also current in folktale among the Atlantic seaboard from Gibraltar to the Hebrides, and among the Yorubas in West Africa, is not to be dismissed as pure fancy." Okay. So now into the text. As the only surviving report from antiquity describing Atlantis, Plato's account is the single most important source of its kind at the disposal of investigators pursuing the lost civilization. His version continues to attract the attentions of both skeptics seeking to debunk Atlantis and true believers who contend that every word is quite literally factual. However, an impartial reading of Plato's account, as it is matter-of-factly presented in his dialogues, the Timaeus and the Critias, leaves most readers impressed that the events described so plainly might just as well be found in the more easily verified writings of Herodotus or Thucydides. I'm not familiar with that name, so I probably butchered it. To be sure, gods, goddesses, and titans are employed, as one may expect, to stand for the powers of nature, fate, and the remote past, just as they were called upon to do in virtually every other Greek history. As such, the myths were metaphors more than actual religious personages. But that is largely the story of men and events well within the realm of Mediterranean experience, and does not overly tax our imagination. The story as it stands seems far less fabulous than factual, if only for its straightforward, unadorned rendering. As William Blackett wrote in his book, Lost History of the World, in 1881, quote, "The case is put very differently by Plato. Divested of the simplicity of storytelling and free from the concealment of mysticism and fantasy, his account of the occurrence takes the form of a great historical event," end quote. The most common argument against the validity of the existence of Atlantis, as presented in the Timaeus and the Critias, is that Plato meant them to be understood merely as fictional recapitulations of his ideal state. While he obviously admires its high culture, Atlantis was not a mirror image of the society described in the Republic. There are very significant, nay, fundamental differences between the two. His authoritarian ideal of a regime ruled by philosopher kings was a single race-conscious state, not a far-flung confederation of various peoples under the old system of monarchs constrained from wielding absolute power by a council of royal equals. Even if Atlantis had been tailored after his work, The Republic, which it was not, the addition of unnecessary, unphilosophic material, lengthy descriptions of architecture, racetracks, etc., could not have illustrated any ideas that were not already thoroughly covered in The Republic, and would have therefore been so much superfluous repetition, something unparalleled in any of the man's writings. Moreover, Atlantis grows corrupt, the reason for its punishment by the gods, hardly the fate of a society Plato hoped to immortalize as his ideal. His story achieves a more proper perspective than when we understand that it was not intended to stand alone as some kind of an anomaly among his other philosophic works, but was rather the first part of an unfinished anthology concerning the major events that most shaped the history of the world until his time. It would have been, by its very nature, an interpretive history, another work on philosophy. The Timaeus deals with the creation of the world, the nature of man, and the first civilized societies. The Critias, which survives only in draft form, was to be a full account of the Atlanto-Athenian War and its aftermath. Its final section was to describe the historical events of the recent past up to the 4th century BCE. So the Atlantis story was intended as part of a far greater project, but essentially no different in character from the rest of Plato's writings. More significant, if his account was pure invention, it would not correspond as well as it does with accessible history, nor go on to logically fill so many gaps in our knowledge of pre-classical antiquity by bridging such a great deal of otherwise disconnected, isolated information. But Plato's accuracy as historian could not be verified until our own century. His description of a holy spring that ran through the Acropolis was deemed entirely mythical until the discovery of Mycenaean potsherds from the 13th century BCE, showing a fountain in the midst of the Acropolis, led some researchers to reconsider his account. Then in 1938, renewed excavations revealed that earthquake activity had closed an underground spring beneath the Acropolis precisely where Plato said it had been. During the 1950s, joint teams of Greek, German, and American archaeologists found their reconstruction of 5th century BCE Athens matched Plato's description of the city with unexpected exactitude. We have therefore every reason to assume his description of Atlantis is just as accurate. Both his identification of the fountain at the Acropolis and his precise knowledge of Athens reflect favorably on historical reliability. There is also some evidence that Plato's account was not altogether unknown to the Greeks in classical times before he set it to paper. At the Panathenaea festival, held every year in Athens, women wore a peplum, a kind of skirt embroidered with symbolic designs commemorating the goddess of their city. Some of the peplum descriptions represented Athens' victory over the forces of Atlantis, not a particularly remarkable fact in itself, except that the Panathenaea was founded 125 years before Plato's birth. The voyage to Atlantis, rediscovered and tragically lost in modern times, was another earlier source composed 150 years before Plato's time by Dionysius of Miletus. A few other tantalizing fragments still exist singed scraps from the incinerated great library of Alexandria, such as a fleeting reference to the 2nd century Roman writer Aelianus, whose Historia Naturalis described how the rulers of Atlantis dressed to demonstrate their descent from Poseidon. The story was given special credence by another philosopher, Proclus, who told how Crantor, an early follower of Plato, seeking to validate the legend of Atlantis in 260 BCE, personally journeyed to the Egyptian temple of Sais, S-A-I-S, I'm not sure how to pronounce that. There he discovered the original tablets, which confirmed the account. Translated, they paralleled Plato's narrative detail for detail. Interesting. Crantor was a prominent scholar at the Great Library of Alexandria, the center of classical learning, where the story of Atlantis was generally regarded as a credible episode in history by the leading minds of the age, including the chief chronicler of the Roman Empire, Strabo. Long before its destruction, the Great Library apparently contained a good deal of supportive material that almost universally convinced its researchers that Plato had discovered an actual city in their outer ocean. It was only after the success of the Christian Revolution that the facts concerning Atlantis, like most of pagan civilizations, were lost. The story was condemned as heresy because it was not found in the Bible and because it supposedly predated God's creation of the world in 5508 BCE, a date arrived at by the curious chronology of Christian theologians. The subject remained closed until the discovery of America, when so many mysterious parallels between the New World and the Old reminded scholars of Plato's Atlantic Empire. Among the first was a 16th century explorer and cartographer, Francisco Lopez de Gomera, who was struck by descriptions of an opposite continent, America, in the Timaeus. But the Alexandria of classical antiquity was, after all, only 75 miles from Sais, and any investigator who wished to verify the details of Plato's account did not have to travel far to read the tablets at the temple of Neith. According to the Roman historian Marcellinus, 330 to 395 CE, scholars at the Great Library knew of a geologic convulsion that, quote, suddenly by a violent motion opened up huge mouths and so swallowed up portions of the earth, as in the Atlantic Sea on the coast of Europe, a large island was swallowed up, end quote. This historiographer, Theopompus, believed Plato's story, as did the famous naturalist Pliny the Elder. The original source materials they once possessed, lost since the collapse of classical civilization, and the fragmentary evidence remaining to us argue consistently on behalf of Plato's credibility. As Zadank Kukal, a modern critic of the dialogues, has written, quote, it is probable that even if Plato had not written a single line about Atlantis, all the archaeological, ethnographic, and linguistic mysteries that could not be explained would lead to some primeval civilization located somewhere between the cultures of the Old and New Worlds, end quote. R. Catesby Taliaferro, writes in the foreword to the Thomas Taylor translation of the Timaeus and the Critias, quote, it appears to me to be at least as well attested as any other narration in any ancient historian. But, yeah, indeed, he, Plato, who proclaimed the truth is the source of every good both to gods and men, and the whole of the whose work consists in detecting error and exploring certainty, can never be supposed to have willfully deceived mankind by publishing an extravagant romance as matter of fact with all the precision of historical detail, end quote. Plutarch, the great Greek biographer of the first century CE, wrote in his Life of Solon that the Greek legislator cited in Plato's story, quote, had undertaken to put into verse this great mystery of Atlantis, which had been told to him by the wise men of Sais, end quote. The city itself played an important role in the Atlantic epic. It was one of the oldest major settlements in Egypt and served as the great capital to the Lower Nile after the unification, which was around 3100 BCE. In other words, at very start of dynastic historic Egypt. As an indication of its and the Atlantean tablets' antiquity, the Temple of Neith, where they were enshrined, was established by Pharaoh Hor-Aha, the first dynastic king of a united Egypt. Even Sanchus, the obscure character who told the story to Solon, was a historical figure whose very name contributes to the authenticity of the legend. Sanchus, in a Greek derivation of the Egyptian god, or Sanchus is a Greek derivation of the Egyptian god Suchos, known in his Nile homeland as Sebek. Sebek was a water deity who appropriately enough worshipped at Sais, where the Atlantis report was recorded, with his mother Neith. It was in her temple Plato wrote that the tablets were preserved. Neith was one of the very oldest of pre-dynastic figures, the personification of the waters of chaos from which the primeval mound, the first land, arose. She was known as the keeper of the most ancient histories of both gods and men. The Minoan Mother Earth goddess and the Greek Athena are later manifestations of Neith. She fell into almost complete neglect after the passing of the Old Kingdom, but the first birth giver experienced a popular revival during the Sati period of the 26th dynasty, when her temple and its oldest records were restored, precisely the time Plato said Solon visited Egypt. Herodotus wrote that Pharaoh Amorsi, had just finished refurbishing the Temple of Neith when Solon arrived in Sais. It is difficult to believe that Plato went to such lengths of mythic and historic detail to create a mere fable. It is no less unlikely that he suspected any connections among the priests Sanchus, the god Sebek, his mother, the goddess Neith, and their intimate relation to the story of Atlantis, recorded so appropriately and unearthed it in so timely a fashion at Sais. Wow. Another point worth noting, Crantor said the story was described on tablets mounted on a pillar in the Temple of Neith, while the Critias tells that the royal proclamations in Atlantis were inscribed on tablets posted to a column in the Temple of Poseidon. The one seems to reflect and memorialize the other. There are many unquestionably authentic touches throughout the narrative. For example, the Critias tells us that each of the wealthy leaders in Atlantean society was required to provide for the national armaments, including, quote, four sailors to make up a complement of 12 ships, end quote. Although it fell out of use in Plato's more democratic times, in Periclean days, and for Some centuries before, wealthy men known as Trierochoi, that's my best guess, Trierochoi, each had to undertake the funding of a warship complete with crew and weapons. Of course, many more of these fragments still exist, even in classical times when the story was generally accepted as a historical event. One of these believers was the geographer Poseidonius of Rhodes, 130 to 50 BCE, who conducted his studies at Cadiz, the Gades in the Critias, in the Atlantean kingdom of Gadeiros. Strabo wrote of him, quote, "He did well in citing the opinion of Plato that the tradition concerning the island of Atlantis might be received as something more than fiction," end quote. Modern critics are less generous. They continue to demean the story as nothing more than a fabulous allegory intended to dramatize principles already laid out in the Republic, with no basis in actual history except perhaps for a sketchy reference to Minoan Crete. All right, a little over a page left to go. In 1956, however, Albert Rivon, professor of classical history at the Sorbonne, declared that both the Timaeus and the Critias embodied ancient historic traditions and contained results of the latest contemporary research carried out in Plato's day. As Ivan Lesner wrote, quote, that a distinguished French scholar who had spent decades studying the Platonic texts should reach this conclusion is most significant because it invests the geographical and ontological allusions in the two books with greater weight, end quote. Glad we're almost done. Standing alone, Plato's account is simple enough, but background information on the principles in the narrative should raise it above the level of a dry report and lend the reader a feeling of living history. More famous in his day than the author of the Timaeus and the Critias was their chief character, Solon, one of the seven sages who grew old ever learning new things, and whose name became synonymous for a wise lawgiver. Timaeus, born in Locris in southern Italy, was an explorer and Pythagorean astronomer. Critias the Younger was an orator, statesman, poet, philosopher, and one of the leaders of the 30 Tyrants. He was also a first cousin of Plato's mother, a vigorous man. He died on the battlefield at Aegospotamus in the Piraeus in 402 BCE as he approached his 90th birthday. Solon's unfinished manuscript was passed on to his brother Dropides, the great-grandfather of Critias, and through succeeding generations it became something of a family heirloom, though these leading characters were real enough flesh-and-blood figures who related the tale with great accuracy. As mentioned above, Crantor verified Plato's version by comparing it with the original Egyptian tablets. The Timaeus and the Critias are not stenographic records of word-for-word conversations, but rather speeches organized to illustrate ideas by ordering arguments into the most logically convincing presentation, a standard exercise in the classical schools of high rhetoric. So when Critias says he hopes he has not forgotten all the details of the Atlantis story, the integrity of the whole narrative does not hang by the memory of an old man. Instead, Plato uses a standard rhetorical device to present his description. More likely than not, he said Solon's unfinished manuscript in front of him. He had Solon's unfinished manuscript in front of him as he wrote out the speeches. He hints as much when he has Critias say, quote, "My great-grandfather Dropides had the original writing, which is still in my possession," end quote. It is even possible Plato saw the original tablet at the Temple of Neith, as many scholars are sure he traveled to Egypt himself on at least one occasion. His narrative gains additional credence in the high standing of the men involved. No fictional improvisations. Their lives are linked to the preservation of the account. The Critias also differs from the rest of Plato's work, not only because of the incompleteness, but also, unlike in other dialogues, Socrates does not interrupt the narrative with questions, a sign, judging from his behavior in the Republic, of agreement. Of course, he may have been saving his questions for later, but that would not have been like him. We, however, should continue to question the story for more answers. The end of the article. And I can really feel my voice wanting to go. So, glad that's done and over. We'll continue with... I guess we won't continue this next week. My new job decided to schedule me to work 3:30 to 11 p.m. next Sunday. So if I do a reading, it's going to be a really late one. I'll probably just skip it altogether and pick up the week after that. So, and we'll get through this section. It's going to take a few weeks, but we'll get there. So, these are going up on the YouTube channel. So if you want to catch the past ones, or you want to make a comment not in chat, you could do that. You could do that on the YouTube channel. I don't get that many comments, so I will definitely. Man, everything hit me at once. I will definitely see the comment if you leave one there. We're going to call it the session there, and we'll see you next, 2 weeks from today. I don't know if I'm going to do a gaming stream tonight. I'm not sure I'm feeling up to it. If I do, I won't be talking much. I'll take a little break and then decide. See you later.